students, welcome to lecture 6 MOOC course on controlled drug delivery systems, which is also unit 1 of novel drug delivery system BP7040. In the first section of this unit, we have discussed about controlled drug delivery system. We have discussed what are the concepts or mechanisms of controlled drug delivery. Then we have discussed about the factors affecting the design of such preparations. Then we have discussed about the drug properties, how important they are in selection of drug candidate for designing a controlled drug delivery systems. And then we discussed various approaches for designing such preparations. Throughout, we have discussed and we have discovered that polymer is an important constituent or important player in these controlled drug delivery preparations, so much and so that the second part of the unit has been completely devoted to polymers. So, hereafter we will be discussing about the polymers. Polymers are basically macromolecules comprising of repeating units of small molecules that are called as monomers. The term is derived from a Greek term which means poly meaning many and mer meaning units or parts. Each small unit making up the polymer is called as the monomer, and the structure of the polymer or the formula of the polymer can be written as monomer with a subscript n, such that several monomer unit will link up to form a polymer like this, right. So, n basically here tells the number of monomer units that are joining to form a polymer chain. We said that they are macromolecules. This term macromolecules was stated by the scientists Harman and Staudinger. They received Nobel Prize for coining this term in 1953 because they had used this term in reference to polymers in 1922. So, these polymers are basically subsets of macromolecules, because macromolecules refers or it is a broad term which encompasses any large molecule. And they differ from polymers in the sense that they may not necessarily have the monomer repeating units in them, whereas polymer is specifically those macromolecules which have got repetitive monomers in them. Now, these polymers, due to their high molecular weight, they can exist as solids or liquids. They cannot exist in gaseous states because of their high molecular weight, and in some of the polymers it is seen, it is very clear that how the molecular weight is affecting the state of the polymer, that lower molecular weights polymer tends to be liquid in state, whereas high molecular weight polymers are solid. Now, monomer, the constituting unit of the polymer, has been defined as small molecules or the building blocks that combine with other small molecules of same or different type to form a polymer. The words important here are same or different types. That is, monomer units constituting a polymer may be same or identical. When they are same, they will lead to what are called as homopolymers. And when we have different monomer units constituting a polymer, they will be called as heteropolymers, or they will be called as copolymers. The terms are used synonymously. So, depending upon whether the monomer unit are same or different, The polymers can be homopolymers or heteropolymers. We will be taking it up in classification of polymers. Then the monomers, they may be of two types. They may be olefinic or functional monomers. What is the difference between these olefinic and functional monomers? Now, olefinic monomers have got unsaturation in them. They have got double or triple bonds, such that when two monomer units will combine, these double or triple bonds will break and form linkages with the other monomer unit. Whereas, functional monomers are those which have got reactive functional groups, such that this functional group will chemically react with the functional group present on another monomer molecule, and then these two monomers can combine together with the release of smaller molecules like water, ammonia, etcetera. So, these byproducts are formed when these functional monomers react. Another term very commonly used in context with polymers is degree of polymerization, represented as dp. This basically refers to the number of monomers in a chain, and depending upon the numbers, we can call the chain as dimer when it has two units, trimer when it has three monomeric units, and so on. So that oligomers, they will be having 30 to 100 monomeric units, and a polymer will be formed when there are more than 200 monomeric units. So, a polymer term will be used when there are more than 200 monomeric units in a chain. Going on to significance of polymers, polymers have acquired lot of importance in our lives, that no walk of life is untouched with polymers. Everything that we are using, the specs that I am using, the pen that I am using, all this board, all are made up of polymers. So, they have wide applications, widely used in different fields, but we will be talking of polymers in context with controlled drug delivery. Before that, let us explore the significance of polymers in various fields. Now, the synthetic as well as natural polymers have been extensively used in food, pharmaceuticals and biomedical industry. They have been used in food, pharmaceuticals as well as biomedical industry extensively, and their applications range not only in product development, but they have been used for packaging of materials also. Some polymers with different molecular weights can have different applications, because the molecular change in molecular weight is accompanied with changes in strength, mechanical properties of the polymer, and its state also. I just now mentioned that there are liquid and solid polymers. Depending on the molecular weight, the same polymer may exist in liquid state when it has got low molecular weight, and same polymer with a higher molecular weight may be in a solid state. For example, here I have mentioned the example of silicon polymers. The low molecular weight silicon polymer has different applications than high molecular weight silicon polymer. The low molecular weight silicon polymer can be used as a vacuum grease, whereas high molecular weight silicon polymer is applied in making implants. A thorough understanding of these polymers will help us not only in understanding the functionality of the drug products properly, but it will help us in developing newer formulations or better delivery products, because only this polymer is a key player in controlled drug delivery. Apart from the drug, polymer is very important, because it is the polymer characteristics that will determine the drug release characteristics of the formulation. Utility of polymers. Now, as I mentioned earlier, that they have been applied extensively in pharmaceutical and biomedical fields, which are of concern to us. So, I will be focusing here on these two particular applications in these two fields. The first application that has been mentioned here is developing scaffolds in tissue engineering. Scaffolds are nothing but they are bioengineered structures which are seeded with certain cells, such that these cells will have guided growth. They will multiply and grow in a particular fashion only to develop tissues. So, the polymers are extensively used here for making scaffolds. Then they are used for making implantations of medical devices and artificial organs. Prostheses is the term used for that. So, they are used for making medical devices and implants, but the main prerequisite of the polymer used for such application is that the polymer should be biocompatible. It should not sensitize the other tissues or should not cause toxicity, and it should be biodegradable as well. That is, it should be degraded inside the body, it should not remain in the body for long duration of time, it should have hydrolyzable groups. Then, they are applied in ophthalmology, dentistry, bone repair and many other medical fields. Ophthalmology, the contact lenses, they are made up of polymers. There are drug delivery systems, ophthalmic drug delivery systems like in situ gelling systems, again polymeric. We have talked about hydrogels earlier. In dentistry, we have got certain rectifiers for dentine. Earlier, we used to make use of wires, and we made use of brackets that used say had a poor aesthetic appeal. So, in dentistry now these brackets and wires, they have been replaced by polymeric rectifiers for the dentines. They are used in bone repair. Sometimes bones cannot repair of themselves by themselves, so they require some additional support, and that is given with the help of biodegradable polymers. Silicon derivatives have been used here, right. So, they find wide application in medical field. Advances in polymer science have led to development of several novel drug delivery systems. Now, they have been used in novel drug delivery systems, nanoparticles, microparticles, all these are basically formulated making use of certain polymers, and they have been used particularly for controlling the drug release rate from the formulations. The polymer properties are very important in governing the controlled drug delivery applications, and by varying the surface and bulk properties of the polymers, we can develop different systems. I already talked to you about nano microparticles, where the size range is different. We can develop micro sponges, right. So, all these are basically different drug delivery applications of polymers. Then, there is a wide research going on polymers with tailor made properties. These polymers are amenable to changes. So, we can change the properties of the polymer by interfering with the polymerization process, and by changing the properties of the polymers, we can develop suitable polymers for particular application. Then, extensive research is going on biodegradable polymers. As I mentioned earlier also, that the tissue implants, they require biocompatible polymers, and drug delivery devices, they depend upon biodegradable polymers, because the polymer, once all the drug is released, the polymer should perish, it should not remain in the body. They are a versatile component of packaging industry. The blister packs, the strip packs, the vials, the rubber closures, all these are made up of polymers. So, they have been extensively applied not only in product development, but also in packaging industry. So, let's go on to the classification or categorization of polymers, because this classification will have implication on properties and hence application of polymers. So, for specific applications, certain features are desired and we can select an appropriate polymer from this wide range of polymers available. So, first classification, there are several bases of classifying the polymers. The first type of classification is on based on source or on origin. Now, based on source, these polymers can be classified as natural polymers, semi-synthetic polymers and synthetic polymers. Natural, as the name implies, that they are obtained from natural sources like plants and animals. Examples of such polymers are proteins, cellulose, starch, chitin, gelatin, etcetera. And the basic advantage of these natural polymers is that they do not pose any environmental hazards. They are naturally biodegradable. They do not accumulate and cause environmental hazards. The second category are the semi-synthetic polymers. Semi-synthetic, the word itself tells that they are semi-synthesized. They are obtained by slight manipulations or changes in natural polymers to have desired properties in them. Examples of such polymers are HPMC, soluble starch, ethyl cellulose, methyl cellulose, etcetera. So, these are the semi-synthetic polymers. Then we have the last category based on origin, that are the synthetic polymers. These polymers are the ones which are completely synthesized in the laboratory. They are also called as man-made polymers, man-made polymers. And the worst part is that these man-made polymers are the ones which are detrimental to the environment, which are posing hazards. Lot of awareness is there regarding discontinuation of use of polythenes, which are again polymers. Just because they are non-biodegradable, these synthetic polymers, many of them in fact, they are posing environmental hazards. However, with research, with application of science, we have been able to develop biodegradable synthetic polymers also. The synthetic polymers are exemplified here with PLGA, polylactic glycolic acid. We have polyethylene glycol and polyacrylates. So, the second type of classification of polymers is based on the structure of the polymer. Now, here based on the structure, the polymers have been classified into linear polymers, branch chain polymers and cross linked polymers. Linear polymers have monomer units which are linked with each other and they form straight chains. As a result, they form closely packed arrangement, and these polymers have got high density and high tensile strength, right? Because of this, they find different applications as compared to branch chain or cross linked polymers. Examples are polyethylene and polyvinyl chloride. Branch chain polymers, these are straight long chain polymers with different side chains. That is why they are called as branch chains, because they have got branches. These molecules are irregularly packed and hence they have low density, tensile strength and melting point. These are exemplified by polypropylene, amylopectin and glycogen. Next, we have cross linked or network like polymers. The name itself tells us that these polymers have extensive cross linkages, right. So, cross linked polymers are hard, rigid and brittle due to their network structures. Usually, they are insoluble in solvents as all polymer chains are covalently tied together. So, these polymers have got different properties as compared to branch polymers or straight chain polymers, and they can absorb solvents. Examples of such polymers are bakelite, melamine, formaldehyde resin and vulcanized rubbers. Then the next category is based on mode of polymerization. On the basis of mode of polymerization, polymers can be addition polymers or condensation polymers. Addition means adding on the monomeric unit. So, these are the polymers which are formed by repeated addition of monomer molecules, right, such that the monomers have double bonds or triple bonds in them. This type of polymerization is also called as free radical or chain polymerization. Example is formation of polyethene from ethene. Olefinic monomers are there. So, condensation polymerization, here there is condensation reaction involved. Two different types of monomers condense together who are carrying two different reactive functional groups. It is also called as step polymerization. You can see here in this reaction how a monomer with two amino group is reacting with a monomer with two carboxylic groups, such that one hydrogen of amino group and OH of carboxylic group are eliminated here as water. They are liberated as water and a polyamide is being formed. Based on the molecular forces, the mechanical properties of the polymers like its tensile strength, toughness, elasticity all depend upon the intermolecular forces like the van der Waals forces, hydrogen bondings, and on the basis of this, the polymers are classified as elastomers and fibers. Elastomers, as the name implies, they are elastic polymers, whereas fibers, they have high tensile strength. Their tensile strength is high and they have high modulus. Thus, these find different applications. Elastomers or rubbery polymers, they have got the polymer chains are held together by weakest intermolecular forces. So, just like rubber, you can stretch them and once the applied stress is removed, they will come back to their original position or retract back because of the intermolecular linkages or few cross linkages that are there. Fibers find applications as surgical sutures and they are used in textile industries. Examples are polystyrene. Then based on the thermal response, we have got two categories of polymers. We have got thermoplastic polymers and thermosetting polymers. Thermosetting polymers and thermoplastic polymers. The difference is that in thermoplastic polymers, the polymer can be softened on heating and hardened on cooling to room temperature. They can be remolded and recycled. Examples: polyesters, PVC, polystyrene. Whereas, thermosetting polymers are those polymers which are not softened on heating. As a result, these polymers are not remoldable or reusable. They cannot be reused or recycled. Examples: bakelites, epoxy resins, etcetera. This happens because their individual chains are chemically cross-linked by covalent bonds during polymerization process, or they have been given some kind of chemical or thermal treatment during their fabrications. These types of polymers can resist mechanical deformation as well as solvent attack. So, they are resistant to heat, mechanical deformation and solvent attack. Based on the type of monomers, we have got two types of polymers as mentioned earlier, homopolymers and heteropolymers. Homopolymers containing same type of repeated monomer unit. Here you can see A is a monomer unit, this polymer has got only A type of monomers. Whereas, heteropolymers, in this we have got two different types of monomeric units, A and B, right. Further, heteropolymers may be classified as random copolymers or block copolymers or graph copolymers. This classification is based on the arrangement of the monomeric units. In random copolymer, you can see the monomers are randomly arranged. There is no sequence. A and B are randomly arranged, two different types of monomers. Block copolymers, there are blocks of A and blocks of B that are linked together. That is why they are called as block copolymers. And in graphed copolymers, the difference is that one of the monomer blocks are present as side chains. One monomer block forms the backbone, and the second type of monomers are linked to it as side chains. Based on the morphology, the polymers may be classified into crystalline and amorphous polymers. Although these polymers lack a definite or perfect crystalline structure as well as amorphous, they will always be found as mixture of crystalline and amorphous forms. The crystalline forms of polymers are characterized by their melting points, which is denoted as TM, whereas amorphous forms of polymers, these are characterized on the basis of their TG, and this TG is important, which is called as the glass transition temperature. This is basically the temperature at which the polymer, the amorphous form of the polymer, transforms from a glassy state to a rubbery soft state. So, this transition is because of the onset of chain motions, and this occurs at a particular temperature that is called as the glass transition temperature, which characterizes the amorphous polymers. Based on the end use, they can be classified into rubbers, plastics and fibers, which mainly differ in their tensile strength, right. Fibers are the strongest of the three category, rubbers are soft and elastic, right. Plastics are stronger than rubbers, but their tensile strength is less than that of fibers. Last category of polymers, or last type of classification, is based on interaction with water. They have been classified into non-biodegradable hydrophobic polymers, exemplified by polyvinyl chloride. They are non-biodegradable and hydrophobic. Soluble polymers, which are water soluble, HPMC, hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose and polyethylene glycol. Hydrogels, which are exemplified by polyvinyl pyrrolidine. And lastly, on the basis of their biostability, we may have biodegradable and non-biodegradable polymer, a very important classification, because it is the non-biodegradable polymers that have led to the lack of fame of polymers or discouraging the use of polymers, because these non-biodegradable polymers have tendency to accumulate in the environment and are the biggest hazards. So, biodegradable polymers are exemplified by PLGA and all natural polymers, whereas non-biodegradable polymers are semi-synthetic and synthetic polymers like ethyl cellulose, HPMC and acrylic polymers. So, with that, I have covered the introduction to polymers, their classification, and in my next lecture, I would be discussing yet another important aspect, that is the properties of the polymer. The properties would be important in finding the right application for the polymers. Thank you very much for your patient listening.